Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Judge, in a 1999 interview with the Christian Science Monitor about the Rice case, you discussed with Senator Hirono a little bit, but you said, and I quote, "This case is one more step along the way in which I see as an inevitable conclusion within the next 10 to 20 years when the court says we are all one race in the eyes of government." It's been about 20 years now, or about 6 months away. Do you think that you were wrong at that point, that racial discrimination in America would be over by 2019?
I think that was, Senator, an aspirational comment, and one that, to your point, of course, I've said in my decisions, as you and I have discussed, that the March for Racial Equality is not finished, and we still have a lot of work to do as a country and as a people on that. So
I appreciate that. I really do. But I want to know what you were thinking in 1999 that would make you make such a bold, aspirational comment that, hey, in 10 years, the court can view this, us all as one race. What was going on in the 1990s that led you to have that belief?
Hope.
Okay, because you and I know, you and I are both aware of where the trends were going in the 1990s. This was the period where the drug war was in full blare, mm-hmm. where the prison population exploded. Since 1980, we've been up 800% in the federal prison population. The massive increases in racial disparities of incarceration. Mm-hmm. Blacks constitute roughly 13% of drug users, but were 46% of those that were being jailed for drug offenses. Even our schools in the 1990s were becoming more segregated. And so your brief in the Rice case invoked Justice Scalia's argument that we should be, quote, one race. And this, let me go on with the Scalia quote, because he said that government can never have a compelling interest in implementing race-conscious programs that seek to address this nation's wretched history of racial discrimination. He said never. He said that race-conscious programs, I'm going to quote him now, are racial entitlement. Now, do you think that someone who wants to remedy the fact that they could not get a loan from the Fair Housing Administration because of the color of their skin is racial entitlement, or are they seeking racial justice? Do you think someone, a person who tries to remedy the fact that they were denied the chance to go to college under the GI Bill because of the color of their skin, is seeking racial entitlement, or are they seeking racial justice? So to be specific with Scalia, do you agree with Justice Scalia, who you reference in your brief, that it's never permissible for the government to use race to try to remediate past discrimination to try to achieve justice?
Senator, that was a brief for a client, first of all, so I was not saying something in my own voice particularly there, so I'm writing a brief for a client.
But if I can correct you, sir, you said it's just a brief for a client, but you seem to invoke Scalia's one-race theory quite often. You invoked Justice Scalia's one-race theory to a reporter. You again mentioned it in the Wall Street Journal op-ed you wrote around the same time, and you cited his opinion, yes, in this brief. Are you saying that you do not share Justice Scalia's beliefs about this idea that people who are seeking to address past discrimination, past harms, that they are seeking racial entitlement?
I think, first of all, the Supreme Court precedent allows race-conscious programs in certain circumstances. So the precedent on the Supreme Court, as you know, Senator, is different. I was writing a brief trying to cite all the, you know, principles from the different cases that would support the brief. But to your point, there's when you're trying to remedy past discrimination as a general proposition, you're seeking racial equality and seeking to remedy both past discrimination and the lingering effects.
So you disagree with Scalia that he says it's never permissible for the government to use race to try to remediate past discrimination to try to achieve justice. You disagree with Scalia?
The Supreme Court law.
I know what the precedent is. I know what the law is. I'm asking what you believe. Do you agree with Scalia that, again, that it is never permissible for government to use race to try to remediate past discrimination to try to achieve justice, that that's racial entitlement?
That position has never been adopted by
I'm asking what you believe, sir, not the Supreme Court.
Okay. The term I used was that what you're seeking is equality. equal and what
and right. So and, so if you're seeking equality, I appreciate you grant that. Is it never permissible for government to use race to try to remediate past discrimination?
There are a couple of things that the Supreme Court's pointed out in its case law.
And again, I know the Supreme Court case law. Maybe I can approach this in a different way.
Okay.
The aftermath of Katrina. In a case brought by plaintiffs in New Orleans who challenged the way government provided grants to homeowners as having a discriminatory impact on African Americans, you joined the minority in denying them relief. If the findings had shown that the grant program systematically disfavored African Americans, would a government effort that uses race to remedy that disparity be unconstitutional? In other words, do you believe that all such efforts that use that the government using those efforts to amount to what Scalia called a racial entitlement? I'm trying to figure out if you agree with that point that Scalia is making.
Senator, first of all, I approach questions like you are asking with a recognition of two things. One, the history of our country, and two, the real world today.
Yes.
And I try as best I can to understand both the history of our country on that issue and the real world today. So I'm coming at it from that perspective. You're asking a question, I think, about specific remedies for discrimination, and there's a lot. I'm a judge, as you know, and so I have to follow precedent, and the precedent allows remedies in certain circumstances.
And again, sir, I've heard you use that with a lot of my colleagues, and I know what precedents are, especially dealing with a lot of very important Supreme Court issues. I'm asking about your opinions because your opinions matter, what you've saved matter. Let me give you an example. In April in 2003, you wrote regarding a program designed to benefit Native American small businesses by saying the desire to remedy societal discrimination is not a compelling interest.
That's what the Supreme Court has said, and
hold on. The Supreme Court said that the desire to remedy societal discrimination is not a compelling interest.
Well, the Supreme Court has let's go to Bakke, for example.
I'm going to get to Bakke.
Okay.
Just answer this question. Yeah. Do you still believe, this is what you said, that race can never be used to remediate clearly proven discrimination? If it's clearly proven discrimination, I'm just using an absolute, do you still believe that it can never be used?
Well, I think the Supreme Court has said it can be to remedy.
I know what the Supreme Court, but what do you believe, sir?
Well,
you know the history. You've recited it numerous times.
I have trouble departing from the Supreme Court precedent and saying.
But you don't. You opined about it in emails. You've opined about it in Wall Street Journal articles. I've heard you opine about these things in race. You just can't say right now what you believe.
Well, a couple things, Sarah, just to back up. Lawyer for client in the email you're reading as well. Lawyer
Christian Science Monitor article, Wall Street Journal, your comments to a reporter. Let me approach it this way, because you're not answering the question, but let me see if I can approach it in a different way. Now getting to some of the things you were talking about. The Supreme Court has said for decades, this gets us to Bakke. Yeah. The Supreme Court said for decades that institutions of higher education have a compelling interest in student body diversity, and that race can be used as a factor, not the only factor, but a factor in admissions if it is done so in a way that is narrowly tailored to serve that interest. You said, the court said this in Bakke, you and I know these cases, said it in Grutter in 2003, Fisher most recently in 2006. The simple question here is, do you believe these cases were rightly decided?
Senator, there are important precedents of the Supreme Court, and as Justice
I didn't ask you if there were precedents. I've heard you go through this before. Do you, sir, if you can't answer it, just say it, Corey, I can't answer this. Do you believe that those cases, you say Marbury versus Madison was rightly decided. You said that. You said Brown versus the Board of Education, rightly decided. And by the way, desegregation cases could come before the Supreme Court. Do you believe that these cases, yes or no, do you personally believe they were rightly decided?
Senator, I am following the precedent of the set by the eight justices currently sitting on the Supreme Court, and to put it in the terms of Justice Kagan, who was asked a lot of these same questions, it would be inappropriate to give a thumbs up or thumbs down on.
Yeah, but sir, there's a distinction between you and Kagan, you and Ginsburg on these issues, because.
Or
let me just tell you the distinction.
It's Roberts, Alito, Gorsuch,
and I'm going to tell
Kagan,
you the distinction
Breyer.
Between that excuse you're using with many of my colleagues. And the distinction here is none of those nominees had voiced personal opinions that government should refuse to defend these kind of programs. And let me give you an example. You wrote in an email about Adirond versus Mineta, a case that involved benefits to minority-owned businesses. You wrote that the government should file a brief saying that, that the program is unconstitutional. And let there be no confusion, sir. You went on to say, you went on to write, that in fact, this is my personal opinion. And so you said that then. My question is do you still think a diverse student body is a compelling interest? You were pined on it then, you wrote it then. Right. What do you believe now?
So a couple things there, Senator. First of all, the Adiran case is in the context of contracting. The Bakke case is in
the context. So you think that those cases, using race to remedy past discrimination, is unconstitutional? That's what wrote then.
Well, in light of the precedent of the Supreme Court representing a client in that case, and I go through, I think the email you're referring to, I go through, actually, we shouldn't, the SG should make a recommendation first that this should not be a White House-dictated answer, and the Solicitor General is ordinarily, I think if you're referring to the email I'm thinking of, but in any event, I think, as you know, and I just want to reiterate, there's precedent in the higher education context, in the contracting context, that are somewhat distinct, and those precedents have been applied by judges. And my record on race discrimination cases, I'm happy to talk about my cases, the EC Ito, the
but
South.
But you're not happy to talk to me about the opinions you've expressed in the past. Do you still hold those opinions now?
Well, that's what I wrote then as a lawyer for a client.
But you said that, let me again, that is in fact my personal opinion.
That's before the case is decided and subsequent.
So you expressed a personal opinion on this issue then. Do you still hold that same opinion now? It's unconstitutional.
I think you're taking, I believe, respectfully, personal opinion out of context there. Personal opinion about what the government position, so personal recommendation, because I said, the distinction there is I said the Solicitor General should first make a recommendation and then the White House should respond or the President. As to personal opinion, it was not my personal opinion, Kavanaugh. It was what the government's position would recommendation would be based on President Bush's
state of policy. Okay, sir. It seems that you were pretty clear there what your personal opinion was.
Well,
let me approach it again. Sir, we don't have to go back and forth. I want to ask you a simple, direct question. Do you think having a diverse student body is a compelling government interest? Do you believe that? Do you think having a diverse, it's not a complicated question, do you believe having a diverse student body is a compelling government interest?
The Supreme Court has said so, and my efforts to promote diversity, I'm very
proud
of.
But I know what the law is now.
No,
what the law is going to be, sir, when you get on the court and have the ability to change those precedents. But let me go back to your words. I just want to ask you about your words and maybe give you a chance to explain something else. Because you haven't answered my question, and I understand that you're going to stick to that. You've also written that an effort designed to benefit minority-owned businesses, an effort to try to give them a fair shake because they had been historically excluded, and these are your words now, used a lot of legalisms and disguises to mask what is in reality a naked racial set-aside. That's what you said. That's how you referred to it.
What are you reading from, Senator?
Sir, I'm reading from an email dated August 8th. These are your words, but I don't need to know about
Can I get a copy of it?
You certainly can, but let's ask you what you believe now. I'll leave aside then.
Yeah.
Okay, you said it, but you wrote it, but my question is, what are your views right now? Do you believe that government efforts to promote racial diversity are a naked racial set-aside? Those are loaded words. Do you believe that now, sir?
The government efforts to promote diversity in the higher education context are constitutional, and I've made clear my own personal efforts to promote.
But you referred to it in the past, sir. You referred to minority-owned businesses trying to get a fair shake after historically being excluded. You call that which is very powerful.
I don't have the email, Senator, so I'm a little.
So have you ever used the term naked racial set-asides? Do you remember ever using that term?
That would, if you're saying there's an email, but I would like to see an email if I'm getting questioned about an email.
Okay, I'm going to ask my staff to provide you the email while I move on.
I have promoted diversity in law clerk hiring and made a big difference in that.
Sir, you've told me about the diversity you promoted in law clerk hiring, and I'm so grateful for it. You've told me a lot of things about the diversity that you personally have practiced in your own life. I really, really appreciate that. I'm not asking you about the five black clerks that you have. That's good. I'm seeking You're seeking a position on the highest court in the land that's going to affect millions of people. Mm-hmm. You've expressed opinions about these subjects to the media, to the press, in speeches, in past emails, but you're not willing to say if you still hold those positions that you held before. And I want to just move on to specifically something that you have expressed opinions in some of your cases as well, sir, and that's the issue of racial profiling. You once discussed the use of racial profiling after 9/11 with your colleagues in the Bush White House.
Can I see the email?
What's that, sir?
Can I see the email?
Yes, I will get you the email, but there was
But I can't answer if I...
I'm going to ask you about your views now, sir, and I'll provide the email, but I'm more interested in your views right now, before you may be confirmed as a Supreme Court justice. There was a debate going back and forth, and one of your colleagues said that there was a school of thought in the administration that if the use of race renders security measures effective, if using race renders security measures effective, then perhaps we should be using it in the interests of safety now, in the long now and in the long term, and that such actions, your colleague said, may be legal under such cases as Korematsu.
It sounds like you're quoting someone else.
Quoting somebody else.
Well, sir,
I'm not going to stick you with that. I know you've already said Korematsu.
But don't attribute.
I'm not attributing it to you, sir. Yeah. Please don't accuse me of that. I'm not. Yeah, I said that was your colleague. I clearly said that was your colleague. You did not respond. You did not respond in the email by denouncing racial profiling or expressing outrage at the idea of relying on a case as odious as Korematsu.
Mr. Chair, point of order.
Can I ask for my time to be paused, Mr. Chair, while you make this point?
Please do.
Pause, Senator.
Mr. Chair, as a courtesy to the witness, we just saw an example there where I even believed that the words that were being repeated were words in an email authored by Judge Kavanaugh. I think it'd be helpful if we could suspend for long enough to have the documents available to the judge so that he can be answered in proper context. Is that an appropriate request?
Do you have any objections?
I do have an objection. If my colleague has an issue with that agenda, I think he should bring it up after my time. I'd like to get back to my question.
Okay, let's proceed. Don't take time away from Senator Booker.
Thank you very much. Sir, your response to that colleague's email was that you generally favored race-neutral security measures, but you thought that there was, and I'm quoting you now, interim question of whether the government should use racial profiling before a supposedly race-neutral system could be developed sometime in the future. So it seems that you are okay with using race to single out some Americans for extra security measures because they look different, but you're not okay with using race to help promote diversity and equal opportunity and correct for past racial, documented racial inequality.
Sounds like I rejected the racial profiling idea. What's the date of the email, Senator?
The date of the email is January 17th, 2002. Mm-hmm. And so have you ever suggested or expressed an openness to, even in a temporary circumstance, like this email seems to indicate, that in an interim question of using racial profiling? Have you ever suggested that, sir?
I'd like to see the email.
I will provide the email, sir, to
you. But it sounds, from what you read, like I rejected the concept, but I'll look at the email.
It seemed to me that you were open to the concept, sir, clearly. This is critically important because right now in our nation, there are law enforcement practices, and I think you're aware that are overwhelmingly target African Americans and other people of color. Yet I've read opinions such as in the United States versus Washington that upheld a search, and I quote, in a neighborhood in southeast Washington, D.C. that you called crime-plagued, in Wesley versus District of Columbia, where you would have protected police from liability when they made warrantless arrests at a house that was in, quote, in east of the Anacostia River. You and I both know that those are predominantly black areas.
Yes.
Predominantly African-American communities.
Yes.
I understand there's case law that says police can justify some actions by saying that they were in areas that were high crime. But you know how some of these opinions, using this type of racially coded language, can further the disparate treatment of people of color with the police. And so the way I see it, and I'll give you a chance to respond, is that you're willing to consider using racial profiling and to accept police practices like heavy policing of African-American neighborhoods, but you're hostile to the use of race when it is used to promote diversity or remediate past proven discrimination.
Okay, can I get 60 seconds?
Sir, go ahead.
Okay. On the Wesby case, there was a call to the police. It was not the police patrolling the neighborhood. In the Wesby case, the Supreme Court reversed the majority decision that had been written by other people that I had dissented from. They reversed it 9-0 this past term. So what I wrote in Wesby, and I was cited And the Supreme Court agreed with with the approach that I had suggested, 9-0. On the general concept, you and I have discussed this in our meeting. I'm very aware of the reality and perception of targeted policing or police activity in minority neighborhoods, and I try as best I can to be aware and understand that, and you and I talked about that, and the Wesby case, in my view, had nothing to do with that issue in the Supreme Court.
So, sir, I try to give you some time there, but this is what I'm hearing right now, sir. And you know, and I appreciate your rhetoric on these matters, but again, you're going to be a judge on the Supreme Court if you are confirmed, mm-hmm. and have a power to make massive differences in our country. And these are real issues. And so I asked you, was the Fisher case, I just asked if it was rightly decided, you refused to answer. I asked you again whether you believe diversity is a compelling interest. You didn't answer that, sir. That's not good enough for a nominee to the highest courts, particularly one who is expressed, and I'll provide you with the emails, as well as other quotes, for the record as well, opposition to affirmative action and efforts to address systemic, provable discrimination, such as, and yet you also have an openness to racial profiling, and again, I'll provide that email. The cases I raise are about addressing documented systemic structural inequality in our country. This is about the fact that children in this country still encounter a different experience of America based upon the color of their skin and not the content of their character. They are more likely to drink dirty water and breathe dirty air and less likely to have access to equal educational opportunities. They're more likely to be stopped by the police. They're more likely to be shot by the police and become unfairly entrapped in our broken criminal justice system. I, like you, you said you're an optimist. I'm a prisoner of hope, but I think, but even I have a troubling understanding in your eyes how America could be just months away or a few years away from becoming one race in the eyes of the law, as Scalia, who you've quoted numerous times. We are a good country with great people, and we're great people because people of all races in America have worked together. Black folks, white folks, all folks have worked together to make progress, but you said it yourself, we have so much work still to do. The Supreme Court, see, plays a vital role in that work, just as it did generations past with cases like Brown. And so, Judge Opportunities, you've answered my questions. I want to move really quick in the remaining time I have to voting rights, which is a crown jewel of the civil rights movement. It's designed to prevent states from putting up barriers for the rights of African Americans to vote. It's in the 21st century, voter ID laws, which we're seeing more and more, many people consider them the modern-day equivalent of poll taxes. These laws are being enacted despite the fact that in-person voter fraud is incredibly rare. You're more likely to be struck by lightning in America than to find a person committing in-person voter fraud. You wrote an opinion in the South Carolina voter ID law that you said you were proud of that decision in my office, and I heard you say it here. I'm taking you at your word that you're proud of this decision. But you were aware at trial that the author of the South Carolina voter ID law admitted that he received an email from a supporter of the bill that said African Americans, he said, that said if African Americans were offered a $100 reward for obtaining a photo ID to vote, it would be, and I quote, like a swarm of bees going after watermelon. In response to that racist email, the author of the voter ID wrote, and I quote him directly, "Amen, Ed, thank you for your support." You were also aware that based on the evidence in that case that minority voters in South Carolina were 20% more likely than white registered voters to have a valid photo ID. So how could you have concluded that the voter ID law would not have a disparate impact on minority voters and poor voters in general? If a registered voter didn't have a photo ID, isn't it true that their only option was to write out a sworn statement that could expose them to criminal penalties? And isn't it true that even then they could only vote on a provisional ballot? Is that true?
So the decision was unanimous, joined by Judge Culler Catelli, who is an appointee of President Clinton's, and Judge Bates, President Bush appointee. But it was a unanimous decision where we blocked implementation of the South Carolina voter ID law for the 2012.
So you're telling me things I know. Can you just get to your feelings on this? Couldn't you see?
Yes.
That this was going to provide an impediment and disparate impact on African Americans. Couldn't you see the problems that this would create?
That's why we said that the reasonable impediment provision could not just be the form that they had prepared, but there had to, we essentially said what would have to occur.
And you said you were proud of me of the reasonable impediment provision. That's where we got, that's the point we had to stop when I talked to my office. Can I just ask you, because this is how I see the reasonable impediment provision. South Carolina tried to enact this law that wouldn't disenfranchise minority voters. When the people who enacted this law realized that they had to make changes to it, you remember this?
Yes.
They enacted, sort of created a second class of voters, those without an ID. They had to go to a separate line, fill out a form under the threat of criminal prosecution, wait for an attorney or a poll worker to witness that. And then after all that, they had to cast a provisional ballot that may not have counted at all. Now, this is a lot of a process. And you said to me, and I appreciate you saying this, you said, what looks good on paper may fall apart in practice.
Mm-hmm.
And you told me, hey, Corey, I was keeping an eye on this to see what was going on.
I think I said senator, but yes.
Oh, sorry, of course. Yes. I'm sorry, Judge. I'm sorry. I feel some comfort with you. Can I just show you what was up in South Carolina polling places? You can see this sign. Right. Here is a picture. This is a sign that was in the polling places in South Carolina after the passage of their voter ID law. I mean, look at this sign, sir. This is what people without a photo ID would have seen. This is confusing and intimidating. It doesn't show the what you call the reasonable impediment option that they had. It just shows this very thing. Do you see how this poster board, you know, might not be really much of, I don't even know if you can see any reasonable provision aspect on this. It doesn't matter that the average voter seeing this poster could be intimidated by this process?
That's why I said in the last paragraph, the opinion, what looks good on paper may fall apart in practice. And what we did in the decision was we said to your concern, I was concerned about the same thing you're asking about here when I was questioning the lawyers at oral argument. And we said the proposed reasonable impediment form wasn't good enough and that there had to be a catch-all box where you could put in any reason. Then we listed all the reasons.
Well, sir, I appreciate you saying all that, but this is the result. And let me go with something different from a person. You and I are nearly the same generation. I want to talk to you about somebody from a different generation that we all think is the greatest generation.
Mm-hmm.
They did try to get a voter ID under the law that you were a part of establishing that was hell. And this is what it was, a 92-year-old South Carolinian named Larry Butler, a military veteran and a pastor of the Lord. He voted in the 2010 election, but in his attempt to get a photo ID, he had to chase down paperwork from his high school records, then go to get his birth certificate, then go to get court records. He went to the DMV, to the official vital records office and the court. And after all that, actually, he still was having trouble. He still couldn't get a valid photo ID. According to the study by the Harvard Law School, the cost of his filing efforts were $36. That's how much all this process cost. Now, I'm not accounting for his time. If he was working, it would have been a lot more.
Yeah.
And so I just want to ask you, because many people call this the modern day poll tax that we're going back. Do you know what the infamous poll tax was in South Carolina in 1895? Do you know how much it was?
The exact amount?
Yeah.
I did not.
I didn't think, but I'll tell you, sir, it was $1.
Yeah.
That was the poll tax that you and I think is despicable and disgusting. It was $1 then, which is roughly $30 today, less than what it cost the veteran pastor, Larry Butler. That's less than what he incurred trying to get up to vote after the 2011 law. And if it wasn't for him holding a press conference with the governor intervening and others giving him a special dispensation. And so here is this great generation where black folks and white folks in this country joined together. They fought and they bled, they died. Goodman, Cheney, and Schwerner dying for voting rights. They grew up at a time when the states like South Carolina routinely placed these burdens on the right to vote and made it impossible and even dangerous to try to cast these votes. I don't know if you see that this isn't that much different in terms of the cost to this person of trying to ultimately pay what was in effect a poll tax. Now my time's about to run out, and I want to say you can answer after this because I've only got a minute and 30 seconds. So let me just conclude, and then I know they'll ask you this. But this isn't complicated to me, sir. Costs like this create structural barriers that systematically disenfranchise African Americans, people of color, and actually poor people of all colors. I'm concerned that a person who believes that we are all one race, like Scalia says, in the eyes of government, that could happen months from now, a couple years from now, a person who believes that efforts to promote racial justice are, your words, naked racial set-asides, that will be blind to the reality of someone like Mr. Butler and the experiences of poor folks all around this country. You refuse to answer a lot of my questions about your views of the race and the law, talking about what Supreme Court precedent is. We are at a time when states are enacting these laws all over our country designed to disenfranchise voters, as one federal court said about a North Carolina law, targeting them with almost surgical precision to disenfranchise them. And now we don't even have the benefit of the Voting Rights Act provision designed to curtail discriminatory laws before they go into effect. Your answers don't provide me comfort. As a justice of our nation's highest court, you will fairly take into account the barriers that continue to disenfranchise minority voters like Mr. Butler today. Sir, I'm an optimist. I'm a prisoner of hope like you. But we have a long way to go. We have work to do. Black folks and white folks honoring the history of a united America fighting to make us more just. The Supreme Court has a vital role in that. And nothing you've said here today gives me comfort. Gives me comfort that should you get on the Supreme Court, that you will drive forward and see that we have that work to do and make the kind of decisions that will make a difference for people like Mr. Butler, people living east of the Anacostia River, north of the river, south of the river, all over this nation. Thank you, sir.
Can I take a minute to respond?
Sure, and then I'm going to recognize Senator Lee.
Senator, a couple things on that. I pointed out in the South Carolina opinion, I wrote the majority opinion, that we see on an all-too-common basis that racism still exists in the United States of America. The long march for racial equality is not over. I cited, I think you've seen, after an African-American hockey player scored the winning goal, and a burst of racial commentary about him, and that was just one of many examples I could have cited in that case.
Racial commentary, can be more specific?
Okay. Racist. Racist.
Racist.
I should have said racist. Racist comments is what I should have said online. And that was just one example I pointed to say the reality, just one example. I made clear that the reasonable impediment provision had to be rewritten. I was all over the real world effects during the trial that you're raising here. I was all over that. So were the other judges of how's this really going to work in practice? How's it? We drilled down and drilled down and drilled down. And cause the rewriting of the reasonable impediment provision to make sure. I talked about the fact, for example, that African Americans in South Carolina at that time didn't have as many cars on the same percentage, and so to get to your point about getting the photo IDs, I made clear that I understood that. We blocked implementation for 2012 because we were worried, to your point about the form, that it wouldn't be enough time to get all this in place and to educate people. It was a unanimous decision. Again, neither side. The Obama Justice Department did not appeal our decision to the Supreme Court. I assume that's because they thought our decision appropriately accommodated the interests of the parties in that case and would ensure that African Americans in South Carolina were able to vote on the same basis as before. And talking about my life and record, and you were talking about that, going back to growing up, but the Law Journal note that I wrote on race discrimination talked about something that I know you've been talking about a lot, which was bias in the criminal justice system. And I said at the end of that Law Journal note that both racial equality and the appearance of racial equality were critical to the fairness of the racial justice system. I provided specific mechanisms for rooting out race discrimination in the jury selection process. And talked about what you've talked about, implicit bias or subconscious racism. I specifically talked about that in that decision. I've been a leader. So there's a 2010 testimony before the Congress about the lack of minority law clerk hiring at the Supreme Court, and Justice Thomas and Justice Breyer were testifying before the Appropriations Committee, and they were asked about minority law clerks and the lack of them at the Supreme Court. And they said, in essence, well, we're hiring from the lower courts. And I remember reading that and thinking, well, I need to do something about that. I'm the lower court. I'm one of them. And so after that, I thought, what can I do? And I didn't just sit there. I went and thought, what can I do? And I started on my own going to the Yale Black Law Students Association every year starting in 2012. I think I'm the only judge who's done something like that, or certainly one of the few. And I just cold called them, cold emailed them, and said, I'd like to come speak about minority law clerk hiring because I'm told there's a problem there. And I showed up the first time wondering how it would go, and I explained and I got a good crowd from the Black Law Students Association. I said, we need more law clerks. There's a problem, and let me tell you how to do it. And here's why you should clerk, and here's how you clerk, and here's how you here are the classes you should take, and here's the things you need. And at the end of that meeting, I gave them my phone number and email and said, call me anytime, email me anytime if you want help. And then it was a big success. I got a lot of emails after that. I helped students get clerkships with other judges. One of them recently finished at the Supreme Court, emailed me thanking me for starting him on that road. And then it was a success, and I've gone back almost every year there. And as you know, we're graduates of the same law school. That's a lot of people clerk from there, so it's a good place to go. And I've continued to encourage African-American law clerks, but it's not just encouragement. I've given them help and advice and been a source of counsel. I've tried to be. And why is that? Because I saw a problem to the extent of the kind you're talking about. And it's one small thing, I suppose, but those are the future people who are going to be sitting around here and sitting here, I think. Those are the pool. And I've tried to be very proactive on that, including my own clerk hiring, where the old networks that prevented women and African-Americans and minorities from getting law clerkships. I've been very aggressive about trying to break down those barriers and be very proactive on that, recognizing that part of this is professors who have research assistants. And so I've done, my cases like the EEC Ito case and the Ortiz-Diaz case, and I think the South Carolina case, I understand your concern about it, but I'm proud of what we did in that case. So I think if you look at your broader question about my life and my record, I understand what you're asking about a few comments in the Hawaii case, but if you look at the sweep of it, I hope it gives you confidence that I at least done my best to try to understand the real world and tried through my actual decisions to understand the real world and apply the law fairly, and through my other role as a judge and hiring law clerks to be very proactive in trying to advance equality for African Americans.